Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Real Vision Daily Briefing. It is Wednesday, December 9th, just after market close here in New York City at 4 p.m. There is no intro section today, and I'm joined by Ed Harrison. Thank you for joining me, Ed.
Good to talk to you, Max.
All right. So we've done this on Wednesday now for a few weeks in a row, and previously we were focused on the real economy. Today, we're going to be focused on markets. We ended in the red, I think, in just about every major index, at least here in the United States, with the carnage spread evenly across the board, with a few exceptions. But really, it hasn't been that way in recent past. So I think it helps to start out by putting today's red day in context of what we've seen over the past few weeks.
Definitely. And yeah, let me tell you how I'm thinking about it. I want to have a conversation about equities. I want to talk about bonds. Then I want to talk about other markets like gold as an example. Maybe we can get to the U.S. dollar. And then once we do all of that, wrap it up and then come see if we have any conclusions. Maybe we can talk to individual positions, individual events like DoorDash, that IPO. We can talk about, I saw JP Morgan had a negative commentary in Tesla. And then once we've gone through those individual issues, then we can see, okay, so what does that all say to us? Because ultimately, the real economy, it seems that the market is looking through the real economy. That's the, sort of the take that I'm going to have as we, in terms of the transition from talking about the real economy to the markets. But now, in terms of the markets, just yesterday, the NASDAQ was at an all-time high. I'm looking at the numbers, and the NASDAQ closed down just under 2% today. You were telling me before we got on, it seemed a little bit like it was a gloomy day, but that's perhaps because it was actually gloomy in New York. But we were at a record high just recently. So really, I looked at the S&P 500 over the last 12 months. It was very interesting to see the chart. The chart shows basically a straight line up. I mean, basically, if you looked at the chart from December to about March, late February, it was up like this. Then it went down and then it resumed, you know, at a lower level, the same trajectory that it had before, to the point where now we are well above the levels that we were a year ago. And this is in an economy that's clearly lower in terms of its baseline because of the pandemic than it was in February. So it's a very bullish environment from a market perspective.
And that's perhaps why the what you're talking about, that disconnect with the real economy, is perhaps why today's day, even in the context of what has been a pretty bullish action, I was looking at the 3 month chart. I was trying to look at today in relation to what we've seen over the past 3 months, because we have seen some more dramatic pullbacks to really come to mind in the last 3 months. And if you were to pull up today on that, it really, you can't even see it. But it's that disconnect from the real economy that makes today sort of feel a little bit more important, as maybe it could be the turning point. Everybody is cautious about what could be the turning point and looking for not only the price action to confirm that, but some of the other signals. The VIX got down to almost broke the 20 level, but with the sort of negative action we saw really more at the end of the day, it moved back up to 22. That's really low compared to where we've been, at least in the second half of this year. But if you go back to where we were in January of 2020, we were down below 20, pretty almost exclusively down below 20, with high volatility being associated with what we're now calling low volatility. So what are you thinking about in terms of volatility in the market and what we're seeing from VIX?
Yeah, you know, I'm looking at a VIX chart from different time frames as you say that. I would say that there was a level where we were by and large from, say, 2015 onward, and the trend was in the low teens. We're talking as low as 9.5 in 2017. You know, so basically we're in that 11 to 15 ratio. There were times where we spiked up. You know, for instance, remember when we had the market throw up because Powell at the end of 2018 raised rates for a fourth time and they cried uncle. We got up to 25 then, but by and large, we were below 20 that entire time, in the low teens, and also even below in the tweens. So when you then look at it from a different time frame, starting from a year ago, we vaulted up from that level immediately up to well above 70, 80 on the VIX. And since that time, on, I would say, three, maybe four separate occasions, we've come down towards that 20 level that you're talking about. That we went down there to about 25 in June before we had the June spike. Then, you know, in COVID cases, we went down to the same level. Maybe it was more like 21, 22 in August before we had another spike. We had another spike right around the election. And then now we're coming off of that and moving down. And so it seems like that 20 level that you're talking about is a level that we just can't get below. It's sort of, if you look at the trend where we are now, which is about 22, and you just draw a line straight across all the way back through the end of the year, to the beginning of the year, you know, it's sort of like a resistance point. We're above that 20. So I don't think we're imminently going to hit to that level that we were before. There's no trend to break below that level. It seems that we're at a higher level of volatility in the market for some time to come, perhaps until we get a definitive outcome with the pandemic and the vaccine.
Yeah, and it is really a measure of expectations, because it's implied volatility. It's not the realized volatility in the market that the VIX is tracking. And so volatility traders, and specifically the guys who are monetizing these spikes in volatility, long volatility traders, were bemoaning it has been a tough market for them recently. And one volatility trader who's been on Real Vision on the plus tier, Chris Seidel, was saying, you know, I wish we could get back to that cheap volatility like we had before we saw the vault up in March. And another volatility trader said, be careful what you wish for, because it is very reflexive. And when you get down to those low levels, you tend to stay at those low levels. So although the options are cheap, there's a good reason that they're cheap. And so it's a kind of damned if you do, damned if you don't world for volatility traders right now, where it seems like the elevated levels of volatility would be good for them, but it makes it more expensive. And so, but if they get that cheap volatility that they're looking for, chances are there's a good reason it's cheap. So it has been a tough go for them. And I find that really interesting that we're keeping at that level. And it could be related to that uncertainty that you're talking about, but I won't hazard a guess as to why we're here. And I would caution anybody trying to do technical analysis on the VIX. It's a good way to get yourself in trouble, especially if you go posting that on Twitter. But the DoorDash IPO was definitely the story of the day. I think it came out. The offering was at 102. It's up 77% on the day. Around 180 is where we are. And the company had their best quarter really ever this last quarter, but still, I think, lost money this year. Can you talk to me about what this IPO says, one, in its timing and the decision by management, and two, what we saw in the appetite for a money-losing food delivery app like DoorDash?
Yeah, I'm excited to talk about this. And, you know, just with the backdrop being that we're going to go through a number of different things that are happening that happened in the markets today in isolation, and then at the end, try to see if we can put them all together. So I'm not going to necessarily relate this to anything else that we're going to be talking about afterwards. But the reason I'm excited about it is that it just seems to be emblematic of where we are right now. I mean, DoorDash is the quintessential stay-at-home company. You use DoorDash in a massive way now. Actually, I just used it for the first time probably a month or two ago, because you're at home. And DoorDash soared to an IPO level of $60 billion, a market cap at 60. It was almost up 100% at some point during the day. One other tidbit that I would say about DoorDash is we have these direct listings that we've seen recently. This is a perfect case of why you get a direct listing, because clearly, whoever was pricing this IPO left a lot of money on the table for the company. Just think, the company wanted to raise money, but they raised so much less money than they could have had they actually done the IPO at the levels that it eventually went to. If it only had popped like 15 or 20%, that would have been much more money in the coffers of DoorDash. But to me, DoorDash is a company that understands get while the getting's good. We are a stay-at-home company that's benefiting from the pandemic. We haven't made any money except very recently. Let's IPO now while we can. Well done, DoorDash, is what I have to say.
Yeah. The question is, are they, I'm going to steal from Dan McMurtry, who was talking about these stay at home stocks. Are they inflectors or non-inflectors? Is this a pull forward of demand that's really just going to disappear when we go back to normal? Or is this, are we really going to change our behavior? Is delivery of food really going to maintain at these levels? And anecdotally, I can tell you that there are a couple of meals which I probably would have gone out to dinner for that I myself ordered on DoorDash. And I know that I will not be having those sorts of date nights, stay-at-home date nights, when we eventually are allowed to go back to restaurants. So I'm a little skeptical that this growth, and even the company themselves, if you read their outlook, they're saying that this growth that they have seen is not sustainable growth, and you will see declines in the growth rates moving forward. But the market seemed to look through that in what we've been talking about, in looking through the real economy, and even the micro real economy that we're talking about with DoorDash, it's been looked through. There's appetite. Risk-taking appetite is probably the nicest way to put it.
Yeah, definitely. And by the way, again, $60 billion market cap. Given you have Uber Eats, where was it the secret sauce? Where's the moat around this enterprise for DoorDash? Is it just a dime a dozen, or does it have some secret sauce that makes it enviable to the degree of $60 billion in market cap? I think that, as you say, this is a frothy IPO. And to me, it speaks to the greater fool sort of theory. It'll be interesting to see what Airbnb does tomorrow, because they, again, you know, they understand that it's on the opposite side of things. They're not a stay-at-home company. You know, hey, this market is good, not just for stay-at-home companies, but actually companies that have been beaten down by the whole stay-at-home phenomenon. Now we're exiting stay-at-home. Let's IPO as well.
Yes. So there's really two ways that you can take advantage of this. Not really two ways, they're doing it the exact same way. But there's two different types of companies that are taking advantage of this. But either way, they're taking advantage of one simple fact, is that the market is really there for, it's benefiting companies themselves and more than anybody else. I think investors look at this market and are struggling to find the best opportunities. Obviously, there's potential for the rotation trade, which has been talked about. They're assuming that does play out. There is some opportunity there, as there have been some serious laggards. But the question remains, you know, how much opportunity is there? And another company that I know we wanted to talk about was Tesla.
Can I tell you, can I read something for you? Because I think this is really hilarious. So it was an article from Bloomberg. This is an analyst over at Bloomberg, Ryan Brinkman, who wrote a negative note on Tesla, even though actually I think he raised his price target, which you can get into in a second. But Tesla shares, they've risen 800% in the last 2 years. Analysts have raised their price targets on average about 450%. And they've simultaneously lowered their earnings estimates for the company for the years 2020 through 2024. And here's a quote from Bloomberg. They say about Brinkman, they say the data is, quote, strongly suggestive of the idea that something apart from the fundamental speculative fervor is driving the shares higher. That's what he says. Up 800%. So earnings estimates down. Something apart from fundamentals is driving the stock.
Yes, and people who have followed his recommendations, I believe they quoted, have lost over something like negative 850%.
That was the money quote. There is that, yes, if you had followed his recommendation this year. They say very dryly, according to Bloomberg data, investors who followed Brinkman's recommendation received a negative 867% return in the past year.
Yeah. And the thing, though, to me that was very interesting, which I think relates back to what we were talking about and people taking advantage of this market, is that today Tesla also offered raised money themselves via a secondary offering of shares, and they were able to raise $5 billion. And only dilute 1%. We talk all the time about companies buying back shares at the worst time and never raising money at the best time via equity offerings. And this, I have to admit that Tesla did did the right thing. In if you're talking about from the perspective of the, you know, corporate executives who are in charge of managing Tesla's balance sheet, I mean, to be able to raise $5 billion in cash and only dilute, I mean, to dilute less than 1% is pretty spectacular. And is an example of how this market is really benefiting the executives who are shepherding these companies a lot more than it is the investors. I mean, the investors didn't get hurt that bad by a 1% dilution. So good on Tesla there for not hurting their shareholders that bad.
Yeah, but, good on Tesla.
Yeah, but the main takeaway for me is if you look at the Airbnb IPO, which is a company which has really been hurt by the pandemic, saying this is the time. A company like Grubhub, which is saying DoorDash, which has really benefited from this market, saying now is the time. And then you have a company like Tesla, who has benefited from this market for non-economic reasons, whatever they may be, saying now is the time. What does that say about where we are in the market?
You were on the call. We had a pre-interview call with Robert Cohen of Double On, who I'm going to talk to on Friday. And I think the term that he uses, borrower's market, because he's a bonds guy. And you were telling me, yeah, I think that the analogy is a seller's market, a insider's market, a corporate executive's market. Yes, that's the market that we're in right now. It's great for the insiders, for the companies that are selling shares, that are selling debt. But unless you believe in the greater fool theory, you might be caught out. The biggest twist to all of this, I think, is what Bloomberg said about Brinkman. You know, do you want to get in front of that freight train? Do you want to go short and get a negative 867% return from taking the advice of Brinkman? Or is the answer to position yourself accordingly, avoid the bubble altogether? It's very difficult for those who have to track the market and who have to get returns.
Yeah, and it goes back. I mean, you and I are not the first people on Real Vision to talk about the incentive structure for money managers, and that it's quarter by quarter, and you have to keep up. And that certainly is part of what is driving the market. And those people like Brinkman who have gone against the tide, they have negative 867% returns to show for it. And, you know, I am not wishing negative things for Brinkman in his career, but certainly that's not a check in the positive column when your clients are going and looking at your research. And so, you know, that's what people are trying to avoid. They're trying to avoid that very thing. And that is certainly what is playing into people buying $5 billion worth of Tesla shares when there are analysts out there saying it's worth $90. And I believe that was a price raise from $80.
Right. Oh, yeah, yeah, right. Even though they're selling at, you know, multiples of that right now. So you'd have to have the company go down like 75, 80% or more in order to get to that price target. Let me just mention one or two other things that aren't in your radar that came up after I spoke to you on the phone earlier today. AT&T, this is a company that I think that Robert Cohen's going to talk to me about on Friday. He was talking about DirecTV. Yes, they are doing a DirecTV deal. They're trying to get it off their balance sheet, even though they want to, you know, maintain control. Apparently, Apollo Global Management, longstanding as a front runner, it put it in a bid just below $15 billion, including debt. That's a Michael Klein's blank check company, you know, that's a SPAC, is among the bidders. So, I mean, going back to what Robert Cohen was saying, it is a debtor's market, you know, a borrower's market. AT&T, they're a triple B that got in over their skis in terms of, you know, buying up companies, levering up, and now they're deleveraging, and they're doing it at the right time. They're getting a huge money, including from top of the market type of vehicle SPACs that are in these bidding processes. So, you know, kudos to AT&T for understanding this is the time you need to get the money, get while the getting's good. Kudos to DoorDash. Kudos to Tesla, and same thing for AT&T. All very good. One last thing on your radar, Max, is that we didn't talk about. I don't know what the story is on this, but apparently the Supreme Court issued a ruling on Fannie and Freddie. And we talk a lot about Fannie and Freddie, you know, with Gabby Hafisa in particular. So something potentially for us to talk about in future episodes.
Yeah, yeah. And I think it's, I mean, the regulatory aspect of it is what's really interesting, is because it is uncorrelated to a lot of the other stuff that's going on. I own the preferreds myself in my portfolio. And so, you know, I saw a lot of red today, and that was the only thing that was green. And so it is that nice uncorrelated aspect to it, which is why I think looking at those little ideas outside of the market, or in a market like this, I believe Robert Cohen, to steal his words, said it's not a big beta market. It's an alpha market. It's a stock picker's market, a credit. You know, you have to go in and do the analysis on these individual credits to go and find the ones where you're really finding where you really think there is value. And I think that the Fannie and Freddie trade is a perfect example of that. Something that's maybe not as correlated, and that there is some solid fundamentals behind. But yes, I'm looking forward to following up on that, and hopefully it goes the way I think it will. But this gives us a good, you know, we talked about credit a little bit. This gives us a segue into the bond market. I know you are keenly focused on the steepening of the yield curve. We saw yields actually rise again today, at least on the long end of the curve, the 10-year and the 30-year, in spite of this sell-off. Earlier this year, you would have maybe expected bonds to rally today, but not so much. So what is it that you think the yield curve is signaling to us?
So I think there are two things that I'm thinking about with regard to the yield curve, and also with regard to treasuries in particular. So if you look at the 10-year, the 210 spread, mm-hmm. it's interesting because the 210 spread was lowering down to about March, and then it spiked up even before the Fed intervened. You know, in early March, it went way up to, you know, 60 basis points. It went down again to about 40. And since then, it's been on a trajectory up. So it's up and to the right, up to about 78, 79 basis points now. Usually what that's a sign of is recovery. What it's saying is that in the future, at some point in time, the Fed's going to raise interest rates, or the economies are going to be so good they can think about raising rates. That's always a good thing when the curve flattens or inverts and then steepens dramatically. That's a bullish sign. And so it would go along with what we were talking about in equity. So equities and debt are pretty much sending the same signal from that perspective with regard to the steepening yield curve on the one hand, and then equities going up on the other hand. The interesting bit, though, is even though the yield curve is steepening, and that's positive, it is interesting how on a day like today, where the NASDAQ sold off by 2%, the yield curve continued to steepen. So I find that a little bit worrisome from the concept, from the prospect of being able to see markets go down, that is equity markets, and then being able to mitigate that downside through some appreciation in your bond portfolio. Because supposedly they're going to be going in opposite directions, but today, you saw a sell-off in the NASDAQ to the order of 2%, and yet yields were up, you know, 3 or 4 basis points, significant amount. I think that bears watching if that relationship's breaking down. What's going on? What's being said there?
Yeah, I personally don't have any insight to add as to whether that relationship is breaking down on a longer term. It certainly didn't hold today, and it's not something new. A lot of people have been talking about that, even as far back as your interview with Ben Inker, talking about, you know, the death of the 60-40 portfolio and this correlation breaking down. Certainly, and that correlation breaking down over a longer time period would be a signal that perhaps the 60-40 portfolio is not long-lived for this world. But one of the assets that I think is related both to the steepening of the yield curve and potentially the death of the 60-40 portfolio is gold. It has been touted as potentially something that could move in to replace some of that 40, assuming that percentage goes down, and it is highly linked to real yields. Obviously, inflation, there's a lot of people talking about that it might pick up, but as of right now, still extremely low, and the yield curve or yields are moving up. So that means the negative real yields that we have seen are I'm not sure if they are, they're definitely not positive yet, but they're less negative. They're moving towards that positive area. And as we've seen in the past few weeks, gold is moving down alongside of that. So what is it, that correlation between gold and real yields that you think is most important to watch?
Yeah, so I mean, if I could extend the narrative of you know, bond market saying one thing and equity market saying the same thing, maybe what we're seeing in precious metals is a continuation of the same thing. That is, as people are looking through the real economic data onto the other side, the vaccine side of things, and they're bidding up equities, they're bidding up the yields on bonds, and as a result, precious metals are less attractive. That would seem to be what the play is. That's why gold has not done as well. That's why silver hasn't done as well recently. Perhaps they're all speaking the same language. You know, when yields are being bid up somewhat, gold is less attractive. So far, all of that meshes together into one meta narrative, if you will. The narrative being that, yes, we're having very difficult times now. It's going to be a long, cold winter. But on the other side of that, you know, it's a pot at the end of the rainbow.
Yes.
a pot of gold.
A lot of gold at the end of the rainbow. But we are down below 1850, at least in the middle of the week. I like weekly closes. A lot of people like weekly closes. So we're not below that 1850 level yet officially by my count, as we haven't seen a weekly close down below there. But at least right now, I think we're down at like in the 1830s for gold. So that's something I'm watching. I know a lot of Real Vision viewers are certainly watching that as well. Gold obviously always talked about in relation to a weak dollar and as a play on the, you know, debasement of the US dollar. That is the one asset that isn't stepping in line with this narrative. You talked about the dollar smile with Kevin Muir and how the dollar tends to rally in two specific environments and tends to fall in one sort of environment in the middle of that smile. But it's not really matching up with that narrative. So the dollar is down. Actually, on the day, I believe the dollar is up. But for the most part, in the past few months, if you look at like a 3-month chart of the dollar, it's been pretty down and to the right there. So what is it that you think the dollar is missing or perhaps is the signal that it's sending us as it's not stepping in line with the other indicators?
Yeah, I don't know what signal it's sending, but this is certainly something I want to talk to Tommy Thornton about, because the last time that I spoke to him on Real Vision, he was talking about he looks for a stronger dollar. I think the dollar was trading with a 93 handle at the time. Now it's trading at a 91. Earlier today, it was trading with a 90 handle. So the dollar's broken down. The euro was trading at 121 something earlier. It's now trading at 180. 120.81. So, you know, it's broken out of a range. The top of that range was 119. So to me, going back to what you were talking about with regard to the dollar smile, what it seems to be suggesting is the opposite of exactly the meta narrative that I was talking about before, which is that all's good, you know, with the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. Instead, what it seems to be saying is, okay, dollar strong when the shit hits the fan. It's also strong when the U.S. economy is doing well, because, you know, relatively speaking, yield should be going up. You know, you're attracting money into the economy. People want dollars. The dollar goes up. But when the economy is weak, that's when the dollar doesn't do as well. So in fact, the dollar is sending the opposite signal with its falling that these other markets are sending. So if there were a meta narrative that you could spin with regard to all the other asset classes that we just mentioned, that is not being reflected in the price of the dollar. And let me just say that the same meta narrative that I've been spinning here is also with copper. Copper had been going up. It's also with regard to oil. Oil had been going up. So, you know, commodities are doing well. Copper in particular. So, you know, I think that the jury is out in terms of if there really is a meta narrative. Now that we're sort of near the end of what we're going to be talking about, I feel as if it might sound good to say the meta narrative is looking through. We're looking on the other side of the pandemic, but the dollar, it sort of throws a spanner in that in the works there.
Okay, so will you be watching the action of the dollar as potentially the last thing to step in line? And if so, are you're counting on a rally from the dollar?
I don't know if I would answer that question. More, I would say, because I don't have a view. I want to see what Tommy Thornton has to say, because he's on the other side of this. He was saying to me, if he's looking, get ready for this, Tommy. The dollar is going to rally, but the opposite has happened over the last couple of weeks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, Tommy and I are on the opposite side of the trade there. So I'm interested to see what he says as well, because I'm always looking for a good challenge to my own view. Well, Ed, thank you so much. We have really covered it all, from equities to commodities to bonds to credit. So it was a lot of fun getting to talk markets, a little less real economy today. Is there anything we missed before I let you go?
Yeah, I was, what was I thinking about is the DXY, so the dollar index. Let me take a look at that really quick in terms of thinking about DXY. If you look at a chart of DXY, since we were talking about the dollar last, take a one-year chart as an example. Basically, it's trended down ever since ever since the Fed intervention. Right before the Fed intervention, the dollar went way up, and since then, it's been going down. It's headed in only one direction, and that's down, and there's nothing that says that it's going in any other way. So to me, I'd like to understand why that's the case and why we should think that it's going to turn in the opposite direction, except in the case of a liquidity panic. So I think that's the big story for me in terms of the dollar.
Yeah, and then there are also those catalysts in terms of, big stimulus packages potentially coming through. As of right now, it looks like a blue wave is unlikely, but there is still that runoff in the Senate in Georgia, which could give the Democrats control of all three branches, both houses and the executive branch. Nobody has control of the Supreme Court, but. There are more catalysts for further dollar weakness down there, and I don't see too many catalysts besides that liquidity event that you're talking about for a dollar spike. Besides, other than the fact that this decline has been rapid and it has been pronounced, and that unsustainable moves are called unsustainable moves for a reason, and they tend to have pullbacks. So other than just like a natural exhale, which is nice. It's a good place to get back in the trade. I think that what we've seen over the past, it basically bottomed out in December, and we've gone basically sideways with a little upward action in the dollar over the last week or so. That isn't a bad thing if you are looking for the dollar to continue lower. That's natural. It happens when you have these big rapid moves like we're seeing. So yeah, I'm with you. I don't see anything stopping it going down at this point other than that sort of liquidity event.
Excellent. Yeah. So that was my last point there, Max. Really appreciate talking to you. Maybe we'll bring it back to the real economy for you next time. Let's take a look and see.
You know me. I'm a junkie. I'm a markets junkie. I don't need to talk about PMIs or anything like that. Let's talk price.
Excellent.